brief about Open Access. This is an IT company that is focusing on geospatial solutions, including the provision of software and hardware solutions as well as training and capacity building. And we partner with a number of leading geospatial companies, including Hexagon Geospatial, Spectra Precision, Digital Globe, Airbus Defense and Space, and Flagbridge. On our key business areas, we're focusing there on sales and support, training and professional services, and you can be able to visit our booth outside here to see what we actually offer. But focusing on what I'm here to do, to talk about emerging technologies, and Gartner has been able to indicate that there are some 10 strategic technologies that are going to affect us in the years to come. And I think some you're already seeing, things like media or tablets, mobile-centric applications, Internet of Things, next-generation analytics, including things like cloud computing. And what we are seeing in the technology that we are dealing with, that is the geospatial technology, we are seeing a number of trends, like thick clients moving to thin clients. We are seeing dedicated servers moving to virtualized infrastructure, private cloud services, things like software as a service. We are seeing dedicated switch circuit architecture moving into IP-based communications. We are seeing limited use of field-based laptops. Instead, we are starting to use smartphones, tablets, and laptops. So these are really technology trends that continue to affect the way we do our daily work. Some of the industry drivers we are seeing change. As we were saying yesterday in one of the pre-conferences, the only constant thing in our industry here is change. The earth continues to change and we need to produce new ones. The quality, in terms of we need reliable decisions based on high fidelity contents of information. Delivery, security, and even social networking. We live and work in a social environment. That's why we are seeing the increased use of applications such as WhatsApp, or Twitter, Facebook, and so on and so forth. And coming from the geospatial sciences, we are also starting to use these means to be able to communicate our maps or our information or even our data. Again, in terms of industry drivers, I talked about mandates for sharing geographic information. We are seeing increased airborne sensors that are growing constellation of satellites. While before we had to spend a lot of time creating big satellites and so on and so forth, now we are talking about micro boxes which are being deployed. We are seeing a number of companies like Planet Labs or even RapidEye or BlackBrick being able to deploy these small utility satellites and enabling us to be able to capture information on day-to-day basis or even hourly basis. So we are increasing the amount of data that we need to be able to process. Again, we are also seeing hardware power is increasing. At the same time, hardware cost is decreasing. So it means that we are capable of getting most of these things in a much easier fashion than it was before. Again, in terms of industry drivers, we are seeing acceptance of web services, standards, and interoperability. Just in the morning before we went for the break, we were talking about spatial data infrastructure for the ASA conference. So we are talking about on-demand geoprocessing. We want to be able to process not only through desktop applications, but we also want to be able to use the web applications to be able to do geoprocessing. And one of the things that is going to revolutionize the way we do things now is cloud computing. I'll show you later on some of the things that people are already doing in terms of developing cloud computing. But it's always important to see where we have come from, so tracing our history. And I don't know who was alive in the 1800s and 1900s. Anybody in the crowd who was alive at that particular time? So maybe you see all this in the historical books, that we have paper generation maps that were rarely updated, were limited to a few, they were not shared. And we had measurement technologies which were perfected by companies like Leica. So if you are still using paper maps, which are rarely updated, which are limited to a few, you are still in the first generation, that is the 1800s to 1900s. But we moved on to the second generation in the 1970s to the 1990s, when it was all about building databases, digitizing paper maps, the file generation, the path of GIS as a technology, the commercialization of remote sensing sectors, and the introduction of digital photogrammetry. And again, seeing the evolution there of 2D mapping. And we went on to the third generation in the 1990s to the 2000s. That's the time when the internet age. Many of us don't remember that internet just started in 1995, at least commercially. So and we can see what was actually done from that particular time. The development of things like web services, internet mapping capabilities, like moving from the desktop to HTML, and broadening of the market from being professional users to being prosumers and consumers of geospatial information. So increasingly we are seeing that we need to be able to share what we are doing, not just to a limited few of those who know the technology, but to the mass who want to know what we are doing on a day-to-day basis. And we have moved on to the fourth generation from the 2000 to the 2010, the on-demand mobile generation where you want things now, instant copy, instant fixes and so on and so forth. So we talked about development of social media, instant messenger, moving from 3D mapping to four-dimensional mapping, the birth of Google Earth and virtual Earth, the synthesis of IT, business systems and geospatial technology, and also development in open source. And looking at the geospatial data really as a driver, a key driver for this technology. And we've moved on to the fifth generation, and I saw a presentation here before, talking about tsunami of data. Suddenly we have a lot of data, we don't even know what to do with it. We have emerging technologies like full motion video, GPU processing, distributed processing, 5G mapping, the cloud. And all the time we are talking about solutions. And we are talking about market expectations and best practices. So that is where we are now moving on. Of course, technology continues to change. So we have moved from early days of navigation by stars, compass and chronometers to GNSS. We are talking about cheaper GNSS receivers, which can be found in personal devices like cameras and even cell phones. And we are now talking about participatory mapping, where you have got volunteer and geographic information, GGI. And given the trends in the geospatial software, they're getting better, they have a shorter learning curve, they're more integrated, they're more open, they're more interoperable. And generally, we are seeing augmentation of satellite-based GNSS receivers. Even the development of unmanned aerial vehicles on how these can actually be used to be able to capture data. So generally, there you can see we are really focusing on information technology. We've got sensors which are capturing the data, and we have software that we need to use to be able to produce that data so that we can be able to disseminate this. And we are continuously fusing the real and the digital world from just not just capturing the data but trying to get some action from that particular data. And just focusing on one of our partners here, Hexagon Geospatial, and their solutions are concentrated in two application areas with customers benefiting from the entire range. They're talking about geospatial solutions and industrial solutions. And with Hexagon Geospatial, you're able to make sense out of a dynamically changing world. The world is constantly changing, and they're trying to make sense out of this. So every day around the globe, we are witnessing dramatic change ranging from urbanization to natural disaster. We face some of pretty big challenges in translating change to action. And action requires information. And understanding change requires data and content. It is really the transformation that goes on from acquiring data to transforming information that we struggle to handle. And we can take the analogy of wind. You know, wind is constantly blowing. That's what is actually happening in the industry. Trying to continue blow and can be able to get even electricity or kinetic energy from this particular wind. And that's what we are trying to do here with respect to the data and the changes that continue. We can see that change impacts our lives and influences our future. As our earth changes, we have greater opportunity to understand, influence, and really become active participants in our dynamically changing world. So with Hexagon, the vision is to be able to make sense of a dynamically changing world. So you have action, you have dynamic and actionable information, and you need to make decisions. So with Hexagon Geospatial, their mission is to be able to make sense to be able to focus on the people, the technology, the customers, and also partners. We believe that your overall experience will be exciting, positive, and professional. We are committed to you. We'll provide you with significant opportunities for your organizations to transition as you grow. And we have a number of solutions from defense, disaster management, to smart cities. I had somebody talking in the morning about smart cities, smart solutions, asset management, to property appraisal. And as a company, we have had a number of achievements, from being the first commercial remote sensing, producing the first commercial remote sensing software, to having the fastest industry compression and decompression format, that is the ECW. So we have solutions that we are able to offer to all. And just to go into one of the products that we have, the producer suite, which is encompassing ADAS imaging, geomedia, and image station. And with these solutions, you can be able to collect, process, analyze, and understand raw geospatial data, and ultimately deliver usable information. And how do you do this? You do this by being able to capture the data, capture the information, and be able to transform it to create sense out of the data that you actually have. So to meet these geospatial challenges, large volumes of data must be collected, processed, analyzed, and understood to be able to make informed decisions about the effects. And that's what we're continuously doing on a day-to-day basis. So with Hexagon Geospatial, we have been able to create software that will be able to drive the entire spectrum of the information cycle. And that is from being able to produce, to provide, and even availing the platform to be able to distribute or to disseminate this information. And just to go briefly into some of these products, GeoMedia, which is a comprehensive dynamic GIS, it's a flexible and a dynamic solution for creating and updating, managing and analyzing an organization's valuable geospatial information with very high discussions. They have not only moved to 2D analytics, but they're also developing 3D analytics so that you can be able to do things like point cloud integration. You can do things like viewshed analysis and shadow mapping analysis, including additional environmental analysis. Image station, which is a high volume production environment for photogrammetry, providing you with the capabilities for stereo feature collection and editing, including digital terrain modeling, production, editing. To ADAS imaging and imaging photogrammetry, which is a powerful offering platform that enables you to be able to turn your geospatial data into actionable information so that you can be able to deal with remote sensing, photogrammetry, even focusing on radar and point cloud analysis. The spatial modeler, SDK, so using this, you're able to build solutions, so you're able to create analysis of the data that you may have. And also handling point clouds. How many of you are dealing with point clouds? Or who at least knows something about point clouds? All right, so one of the things that people keep on talking now about is point clouds through LiDAR, but not only through LiDAR, you can also be able to get point clouds from stereo images. And you know, with the point clouds or with LiDAR, it's enabling us to be able to measure the world in a manner that we were not able to do before. Suddenly we can be able to have billions and billions of points that are representing X, Y, Z information. And you can see that with this information we can be able to have very elaborate representation of the Earth surface. And we go further into the possibility of even being able to customize the ADAS imaging interface so that you can be able to build your own applications and be able to turn on the platforms here and there. We have enhanced change detection so that you are able to now do things like optimize object-based passive change detection, or do integrate simple workflows, or streamline their processes. But another thing is that, as we have said, that there is an explosion of data. The software that we have is allowing you to be able to connect through Hexagon Connect content connections, so that you can be able to exploit information I mean, just things like imagery into your working. You don't necessarily need to own the imagery, but you can be able to do a connection. Provided you have the internet connection, you can be able to get that, and you can use that as a desktop, and you can be able to capture the information that you need. So, more closely, we've been able to have this product, which we're calling the producer suite, which enables you to be able to extract data and to have deeper insights and be able to undertake some scattered analysis. You are able to collect and process more data. You are able to turn that data into insightful analysis. You are able to integrate data, point clouds, and motion video. The software is easily customizable. It is unparalleled in terms of supporting analysis and even decision making. And you can use it across disciplines, from national mapping agencies to mapping companies, to natural resources, to forestry, to defense and intelligence, and so on and so forth. But in addition to that, we've also got what we are calling the provider suite, which enables you to be able to easily store, discover, manage, and deliver your data across desktop, web, and mobile applications. One of the products that we have there, the Edus Apollo, which is a comprehensive enterprise data management solution that helps organizations to be able to catalog, publish, and to deliver large volumes of your spatial data. So when you're talking about SDIs or spatial data infrastructure, then this fits in as a solution that is capable of doing that. Because people want a medium where they can go and interact, they can type maybe the name of a place, and they can be able to get data of that particular place without spending a lot of time and energy trying to look for the same. So that's why SDI, or spatial data infrastructure, is a beautiful subject. The other thing is about the ECW. Now, how many of you are using imagery? You're using imagery, and what are some of the problems that you experience when you're using imagery? Sorry? It's light, it's big, you need storage capacity, you need processing power, your machine needs to be a super machine, and so on and so forth. So sometimes it's difficult to handle big data. And I saw a slide when you're talking about the ASA conference, talking about big data. This is big data, and it's being generated on a day-to-day basis. So you need capability to be able to compress that imagery. And the world's leading compression format is ECW, Enhanced Compression Wavelength. And they did some work in Germany. I think they had, like, they flew over Germany and they had, like, 32 terabytes of data. And they were able to reduce, using ECW technology, to about 100 MB, so you can imagine, and without losing the clarity or the content. So that's what ECW does, and you can be able to use it whether you're using ArcGIS or using any other software. You have plugins for ECW, and these are free. You can actually download them and have them. Just go to the internet, download ECW plugins if you're using ArcGIS, and use them. So that's about the compression and what you actually get from the compression formats, how you can actually be able to reduce on the time, reduce on the resources, save hours, if not days, that you actually need to be able to process the data. Then we have the platform suite, and this one has solutions like Jumedia Smart Client, Jumedia Web Map, Spatial SDI, and even Mobile Web. So these allow you to be able to create your own unique solutions on top of solid foundation of powerful discussion functionality. Something like GeoMedia Smart Clients is basically an application that is, you know, when you're talking about GIS, you've got some people who are technically trained and they can be able to understand all the details about the GIS and so on and so forth. Then you've got people who just want to consume that information that they're creating from the web. So they will need to use things like Internet Explorer or Mozilla Firefox. They're not interested in knowing how you're doing this analysis and that. They're just interested in that. But in between there, you have some people who they're not so technical, and again, they want to get something a little bit more. then that is where the media's first client is fitting in, allowing me to be able to do things like how it works, especially like within a local and government, the local authorities, so that you can be able to do like building, processing, permits, and so on and so forth. We have a simplified application that can then be used to be able to trace the transactions that the organization is carrying on a day-to-day basis. So you have the, on the web PIS with your media web map and the special SDI and the special portal, just trying to go through all that. We can discuss more details from our book. In addition to that, we are able to have the mobile MapWorks, which is a tablet-based application for field personnel and employees, so that you can actually take the GIS to the field and be able to collect the data from the field, working from a tablet. The beauty of the tablet is that you have a bigger surface area. You have like 7 inches or 10 inches that you can be able to work with. So it's better than working with a phone, and it's better than the handheld GPS that we have, because the screens are smaller, 3.5 inches. So here you can work with 7 inches, and we have seen that people maybe working on utilities and so on and so forth, they would prefer to have a bigger surface area to work with. And like even when you're doing sensors and so on and so forth, it's a beautiful application. Finally, we have got this application called Mobile Alert, which is a freeware. You can install it if you have an Android phone, Windows phone, or iOS. You can go to the applications on site for Mobile Alert, and you can be able to install it. It's a free application. What does it do? It allows you to be able to report incidents. So maybe there's an accident, you can capture that information and send it to an organization like the police and so on. It will take the photo, it will take the coordinates of that particular point, and it will also produce a map of that particular area. And I told you, we are in an era of social media. People want to use social media. We don't have to wait for the print media. We don't have to wait for the news at 9 o'clock in the evening to be told this and that is happening. So like right now, if you have mobile alert on your phone, take a photo of me and you already post it, and the world can be able to know that there's something that is happening in my career. So try and do that. You've got that mobile alert, you can be able to install it, it's free, a free application, and you can see how it's actually used for that. Of course, the thing would be like maybe the roads authority would need to have to buy it, and then if you have any incidents, you can report it, you go directly to them. But for you, as somebody who is capturing information, it's free of charge. And I think talking about this and seeing where we are coming from, we are mainly people from the education industry. The question we'll be asking is, what is the need for us? The Hexagon Geospatial is offering free geospatial education campus-wide grant licenses, up to 500 licenses per university. This is entry-level GIS and entry-level remote sensing. 500 licenses for each university. We also have the Geospatial Education Desktop Core. Those are annual licenses or permanent licenses. And we also provide server licenses, and we give out free educational SDKs. So for students who, or even faculty who would like to do on that certain subjects here and there. Just to stress on this free annual geospatial educational campus wide, so that you don't have to use pirated software, right? If you've got a pirated copy, you can give it to me now and I give you free software. Up to 500 licenses were set by university, entry level, your media essentials and imagine essentials. The comparable commercial value is $5,000. So if you're looking at 500 licenses, that is $2.5 million. We are saying you can have that for free. And if you have it, the students can be able to do the assignments, you can be able to teach. If you have issues with developing the training materials and so on and so forth, we can also assist you in doing the same. So I think you need to be able to take advantage of that particular fact. These licenses are basically there for you to be able to use, because we understand that you are involved in teaching and research, and that you may not. We have said that within our industry, change is really the only constant. And sometimes you are sitting there and looking into space and wondering what is really happening. Or sometimes you need to be able to take some risks, like do bungee jumping. Who has done bungee jumping? I don't know, sometimes I wonder who is so crazy enough to get to jump. What about if that rock snaps? I think it helps sometimes. You need to try and do this. I wouldn't do it myself, but try and do it. We are seeing a lot of changes, a lot of data and so on, and sometimes we have a fear of spending a lot of money on data and not being able to capitalize on that data. Because sometimes you have data and then it just sits on the shelf. You buy software and it just sits. Then you're wondering, why do you really buy it? You know, it's like you have the investment and then you have money, like I don't know what, 10 million or 100 million Uganda shillings, you put it in the toilet and you flush it. Same thing like having the data sitting on the shelf and they don't care. So the fear of not knowing how to inject new data sources into your workflow is really an issue that we need to be able to address. And the fear of not being relevant, you're not providing answers, you're just providing maps. I don't know whether you've been in that kind of a situation. You're using GIS to provide answers. Are you providing answers? So join me on a transformational journey and fearless experience. And I've already said about this power of only six, but as I was talking about producer, provider, platform, we agreed yesterday that if somebody asks you what is it that you learned or you are there for the conference for the 3 or 5 days, three things: producer, provider, platform. This is from the Power Portfolio 6 from Hexagon Dispatchal. So Hexagon Dispatchal has taken that leap into the future to now go into providing software through the cloud, cloud delivery of software. And this is where technology is going. Technology is not going to be on the desktops. We are moving away from the desktops to the cloud. Software is going to be delivered on the cloud, where you use it when you want to use it. When you don't want to use it, you don't use it. You pay for it when you use it. You don't have to have it sitting on your machine. You spend $10,000 or $20,000 to buy the software. You never use it. You use it once in a year. Right? So again, it's like flashing that money on the toilet. So we are introducing producer online. And so with this you have Imagine and GeoMedia online, and you can be able to have access to that. Already you can do a trial version for 7 days for the producer online, and you can be able to work with it just like you would work with the normal software. I know some of you may be scared that you're thinking that if I'm working online, people can be able to see my data and so on and so forth, what is the security associated with the same, but it will do caching on your machine. Your data does not have to leave your computer to sit somewhere, so you have full control over that. So don't have any fear. That's what I'm saying. Are you prepared to do bungee jumping, to jump into the future? Again, Hexagon is also combined with working together with Airbus Defence and Space to be able to bring to you the imagery that they're capturing. With Airbus Defence and Space, they're capturing 4.1 million square kilometers of imagery every day. In total, in the archive now, they have got 100 billion square kilometers. And this archive is growing daily. So, this 4.1 kilometers, square kilometers, is like the Earth's landmass being collected every 37 days. That's how much information they generate. And again, we have other companies like Black Sky Global. Again, you can be able to see what they're doing. What we're saying is that we can be able to deliver to you online content. You don't have to. We're getting to a position where you don't have to own the image, because the image is changing so fast. It's changing daily. If you have it today, tomorrow it is outdated. So So rather than again spend a lot of money keeping on buying this and that, what technology is saying is that you can be able to consume this when you want it. Right? Just like you're using Google Ads. Some of you are using Google Ads, although sometimes it's not a budget that you possibly could pay. But here you'll be talking about a very good data, very rich content, very accurate data being provided to you through an online service. And working with companies like Amazon and the rest of the data to deliver that. Again, just running out of time here, but moving into another area in terms of the kind of data that we are having. You can see from the screen there the kind of data that is actually being generated that needs to be managed on a day-to-day basis. But another thing that I need to leave us with is, what is the map of the region? You know, we started by saying that we started with 2D maps. We went into 3D maps. We went into 4D maps. We are talking about five-dimensional maps. You know, did you ever think that if you are sitting at home and you are watching a soap, reality TV, that is 5D map? Because then you have X, Y, Z, T, and I. So you have to be doing math. So next time you're watching a soap, you're actually doing math. You're actually promoting your special science. So what is the map of the future? The question that is. The map of the future is not just a map. A map is not alive, it is dead. Right? The moment you produce that map, that information is out. A map is not fresh. Right? If you produce it now, it is already old. A map doesn't give you answers. A map is a reflection of what was. It is historical information. So the map of the future will tell us what was, what is, what can be, what will be. That is the map of the future. These are the maps that you are going to be producing in the future. I asked you before, can you do bungee jumping, take a leap into the future? This is what the future is going to be. Because if you are doing traffic maps, you want to see what is actually happening at that particular time. You don't want to be told what was happening in 1960. How is that going to be? You want to see now. You see? So it's like watching TV. So Hexagon is introducing what they're calling Hexagon Smart Map. They have been able to take a leap into the future. They're introducing this smart map that will be able to enable you to build and be able to deploy smart applications. And you'll be able to have a portfolio that is distinguished as that Foundation, Studio, and Exchange. This is yet to be launched, but it's really going to be something that is going to revolutionize what we are actually doing in the industry. So stay tuned to be able to see what is going to happen with the smart maps, the introduction of the map of the future. And if you like, you can come and experience the smart map application at Hexagon Live in Hong Kong.